There's this scene in Welcome to the NHK that polarizes people. In it, the main character elopes with his estranged high school sweetheart to a deserted island, or so he thinks. There's been a bit of miscommunication, and she's actually roped him into an offline meeting for a group of people who want to kill themselves. A lot of things happen, and then he really does try to kill himself. And then he's stopped when his friends arrive on a boat to shout up at him that he's not a completely worthless human, so he should hang on in there. And then he very nearly falls off the cliff they're on and dies anyway. If you don't know whether this sounds hilarious or really sad, now you know why that scene drew some very different reactions from viewers, and you also know how all of Welcome to the NHK feels. The premise of this one is pretty simple. We start out with our lead character, Tatsuhiro Sato, a 22-year-old university dropout and hikikomori living alone in Tokyo. The NHK is Japan's national broadcasting organization, but in this show, Sato assigns the acronym a new meaning, the Nihon Hikikomori Kyokai. He's convinced of his own conspiracy theory that the NHK exists to get people hooked on anime and ultimately doom them to live out the rest of their lives in social isolation. Yes, Sato is more than a little mentally unstable. One day, he actually manages to make a human connection through a series of random events and becomes not really friends with a girl called Misaki Nakahara, who begins to give him counseling sessions in a park late at night to help ease him out of his agoraphobia. I would call Welcome to the NHK a black comedy, one that draws humour out of the really dark situations we can find ourselves in everyday life. And yet, the content is played completely straight. Scenes that make you laugh one day could make you cry another, just because they hit that bit closer to home or touch on a nerve. I think that in this way, NHK really manages to capture what life actually feels like in a way few works do. To me, the thing that really sets NHK apart is the way it doesn't feel like a story so much as like you're a fly on the wall, following Sato around. None of the characters are written to be likable. That doesn't mean they're written to be dislikable either. They're human and uncontrived. It's one thing to craft three-dimensional characters with the intention of the audience caring for and emotionally engaging with them. It's another to just show people the way they really are in the day-to-day of their unremarkable lives. It makes plenty of sense, too. At one point, I searched the author of the original NHK light novel, Tatsuhiko Takimoto, the way I often do when I really like a work of media and want to know more about the person whose mind it came out of. I don't know what I was expecting, but what I found made me really sad, actually. So much so I kind of wished I'd never gone looking. Takimoto is himself a hikikomori. He's had a few series since NHK, but none that have gained as much popularity or much at all as I can gather. I also found some direct quotes from the afterwards of two NHK re-editions. In one he states, quote, "The themes addressed in this story are not things of the past for me, but currently active problems." In a second, he goes on to say he had, quote, "not written a single new story since NHK, and that he was reduced to a neat, living as a parasite on the royalties from this book." He also stated that he felt completely unable to write and incapacitated. Now, these are from 2001 and 2005, and I'm going to hope the lack of news since then is, in this case, good news. But really, that's just what's most comfortable for me, isn't it? These sentiments stuck with me. For one, we can more or less surmise from them that NHK is largely based on Takimoto's own life and experiences. This isn't a particular surprise. Beyond the specific understanding of what it's like to be a hikikomori, there's a way people who know suffering write about it. And then, haven't we all suffered before? NHK isn't really a show about being a hikikomori. It does touch on the roots of the issue, the particular weight placed on being a productive member of society that exists in Japanese culture, otaku identity and the genuine social stigma and shame that can come from it, the intensity of living in a capitalist society that demands a very specific kind of work ethic, and the ways this pushes anyone who doesn't fit the mold by the wayside, particularly the mentally ill and disabled, as well as the ways we questionably pathologize this inability in itself. Then, the cycle of stress, depression, and then resignation that comes from trying to force yourself to confront the issue, and the learned helplessness that thrives on every failure to do so. At its heart, the Hikikomori epidemic is not surprising at all, especially when contrasted with Japan's notorious working standards. Anyone who's had to work to earn themselves a living in the current global economic climate, or who's felt the pressure of having to decide seemingly on what to do with the rest of their life in early adulthood, can relate to the character's plight. Seto isn't likable, and he isn't dislikable. He isn't meant to be. Nor is he just a mirror for us to see our own experiences in. He's one human struggling to get by, as are every one of his co-cast. And for every moment where Sato makes a particularly poor judgment call, there's another that reminds me of that. He never asked for my judgment. NHK kind of amazed me with how many times it managed to draw me back to this conclusion, considering Sato is certainly worthy of criticism. The show made me somehow feel this strange mixture of pity, secondhand embarrassment, amusement, and disgust. NHK isn't afraid to do this, presenting us with situation after situation where Sato's social ineptitude is painfully, uncomfortably evident. The shame Hikikomori themselves feel, as well as the perceived disdain with which society view them, are equally evident. NHK is also prepared to portray its characters' questionable actions, things many other anime make light of, without the intention of comedic effect. They're put to us without any real effort to make us laugh, as if to say, here, is this still funny? I think NHK has plenty to say about toxic masculinity, merely by virtue of showing us how its male characters act when there's nobody around to judge them for it. But I can't be angry at what is a completely honest portrayal of the attitude that has become normalized amongst our internet-reared generation, one that thrives on pornography consumption, objectification of women, and the inevitable disconnect when young men who've been brought up in this environment try to reconcile this exposure with seeing women as actual complex humans who exist to do more than titillate. Throughout the show, women are painted as the source of many of the two main male characters' sorrows, largely in the form of being failed romantic conquests. Where other shows would make this mistake without ever realizing it was one, or else might fix it later simply by shining a spotlight on and directly criticizing these characters' treatment of women, NHK does something else, something even more interesting. It shows us these women are no better than their male counterparts. Now, that's not to say they're as bad as Sato and his friend Yamazaki can get, nor responsible for how they view or treat them. The show simply laughs at the idea that they might be able to solve said male characters' existential issues when they're already struggling with their own. At the start of this show, I thought Misaki's existence as a character was kind of sad. Most people like Sato will not have someone magically turn up at their doorstep to fix their life for them. I've seen a lot of people echo this sentiment, but that was never the point. Misaki can't do anything for Sato. And then you get the occasional moment where these characters finally seem to see eye to eye, where they see the true value in having one another is to be able to honestly voice their feelings and have somebody else understand, and those moments shine. There isn't clear progression in NHK, there's barely even a plot, in my opinion, and that's not a bad thing. Rather than portraying an unrealistic, linear journey, NHK works because it acknowledges that life doesn't work that way. We take a step forwards, we take two backwards. We learn something and grow, but struggle to implement it. We know who we should be or want to be, but don't know how to realize that vision. We struggle on and clamber over each roadblock messily, sometimes barely making it. Remember, this isn't a show about idols, but worthless humans. People like you or me. NHK also knows how to portray mental illness. While it could be mistaken for one of the more stylistic elements of the anime, the novel is more explicit about exactly what kind of mental state Sato is in, where his hallucinations and delusions are directly linked to psychoactive drug abuse. The series carries a very distinct tone, always tinged with a surreality and sense of detachment that exemplifies what it feels like to live in a state of extreme social isolation and depression shockingly well. The sound design and music, in particular, do a really great job at this. The show is littered with these amazingly realized, gorgeous background shots, sometimes as many as five flashing across the screen for just a few moments each. They work to, of course, realise the setting, but they often portray inconsequential scenes. The outside world, most often contrasted with Sato alone in his apartment as the seasons cycle by. There are hints of an unreliable narrator. Sato spends so much of his time in his head, either due to anxiety, rumination and paranoia, or else simply having nobody to speak his mind to, that it's sometimes unclear whether what's being presented to us is actually happening. Multiple times, I was completely taken in by a scene, only to realise it had happened in a dream or Sato's imagination. The show is at times whimsical and at others thick with existential dread and tinged with mental instability bordering on insanity. NHK is, more than anything else, a show about loneliness. The simple reality of what can become of a person who has nobody else. And while Sato's situation may be on the more extreme end, I would say NHK is a show that really captures the feeling of being a young adult, the one few people discuss and even fewer works portray, which is very much complicit in it catching people so off guard. Being a young adult is lonely. For many people, it entails starting a social circle from scratch in a brand new place. At the same time, you are thrust into the frightening reality of being responsible for keeping a roof over your own head and finding a means to do so that won't leave you utterly depressed.
It's hard.
In Sato's case, his generous allowance from his parents might ultimately be a huge pitfall in his necessary journey to independence. A concept backed up by psychological research, linking overprotective parenting to an overly anxious disposition. More concretely, it provides the safety net that ultimately allows Sato to keep living as a hikikomori. NHK hit really close to home for me, and it really nails that precarious and painful tightrope you walk as a loved one trying desperately to support a family member or friend going through a hard time without enabling their unhealthy habits. In spite of everything I've said, for a show with a largely pessimistic tone, NHK has always to me brought a sense of comfort, the kind that comes from seeing your struggles acknowledged. The series makes a point to show us Sato's life before the onset of his hikikomori tendencies. I really like the way that through his high school days, he is only ever shown as having a meaningful relationship with Hitomi and Yamazaki. Again, NHK endeavours to show us things as they really are. It is the opposite of escapist media. How many of us can say our school days actually looked like K-On? I equally love Hitomi and Sato's relationship, as easily one of the most realistic I've seen in media. From the undefined nature of their school fling, a product of hormones, curiosity, attraction, boredom, and above all, isolation, and how it follows them into adulthood. They equally use one another as a vision of wish fulfillment. Sato fixates almost desperately on what could have been between the two of them, with Hitomi being the closest he's ever come to a romantic relationship and likely the only person he's ever slept with. Hitomi turns to him in moments of dissatisfaction in her current relationship without any true interest in him or seemingly the same lingering regrets, because the grass is always greener. Sato comes to fixate on Misaki in a similar way, despite eventually turning down her proposition of a relationship. It's easy to do when romance is constantly thrust at us as the solution to all our problems, the ultimate goal. NHK manages to be raw and punchy through its mundanity. It highlights the forgettable moments of everyday life, the ones that leave you briefly remembering why you're still here, or the ones that equally threaten to push you over the edge. NHK's focus on the unremarkable is evident in everything from its understated, unaffected voice acting to even its, at times, rough animation. This isn't a pretty show on any account, and it works that way. NHK is one of the most solidly fantastic anime I've ever seen, and I can't think of one episode in its run that doesn't feel as though it contributes something meaningful to the show's themes and overall impact. It's consistent, unchanging to the point of stagnation. For all intents and purposes, Sato's position in the final episode as a full-time employee going out every day to earn himself a living should be the ultimate demonstration of clear character progression. And yes, Sato progresses, at least to the point where he can leave the house without having an anxiety attack, but I don't think that's the point. The show also ends with Sator signing Misaki's contract, essentially promising not to kill himself because she'll kill herself if he does, and vice versa. It's the epitome of the show's black comedy, and another scene that I couldn't actually bring myself to laugh at because of how painfully familiar it was. While there is progress here, the characters are still tortured. It's only at the very end of the show that we find out the tragic reality of Misaki's situation and everything that has led her to become the way she is. That is, utterly codependent. NHK excels in managing to explain mental illness-driven thought processes in plain language. The revelation of Misaki's past is especially poignant when we've already spent the series watching her say and do questionable things. Like Sator, we wonder about her quirks, but enough time passes and the curiosity dampens. If her behaviour is ever a little morbid or concerning, well, that's just Misaki, right? It's equally an approach I've taken in the past towards people I knew I had reason to worry for, but who never opened up, and who I settled into a complacent kind of acquaintance with, where we called each other friends but failed to pry or press a little harder where we perhaps should have. The look on Sato's face as he finally learns everything, that Misaki's father died when she was a child, that her mother most likely killed herself in front of her, and that she spent the rest of her childhood being abused by her stepfather to the point of believing nobody could ever want or need her, says it all. All this time knowing her, and he'd simply never tried to find out. And it all makes this terrible kind of sense as he makes the same desperate dash she had 12 episodes earlier to stop her from killing herself. These last episodes are masterful. I can't say anything but that if you've been there, you know. The dialogue and acting are the star here. There's Sato's desperate conversation with Misaki, the simultaneous realizations he cannot do anything to stop her, will never have the words, and that perhaps he has no right to. The lines in this scene are hit after hit. Does it matter if Misaki dies? It happens to everyone in the end. The only difference is if it's early or late. I equally love their final lecture before this, where Misaki reads out inconsequential, famous last words, underlining the message in bold. Our lives are not drama plots. There's no ceremony to this stuff. When Sator reaches Misaki, he's angry and tired. There's no dramatic love confession or eloquent speech, just a lot of desperation and raw emotion. The series is great at these outbursts, the contrast in the depression of living an unsatisfactory life, and the consequential build-up of frustration we often end up taking out on the wrong people, because there's not really anybody to blame. The question of how we cope with our suffering is as old as humanity itself. And I don't mean how we solve it, but how we conceptualize and justify it. NHK plays with fundamental concepts from psychology and philosophy as it discusses the theories humans have devised through the ages to answer these questions, really honing in on Epicurus's argument from evil. Simply, if an omnipotent, omnibenevolent, and omniscient God exists, then evil does not. There is evil in the world. Therefore, an omnipotent, omnibenevolent, and omniscient God does not exist. As it does with mental illness, NHK is great at breaking these ideas down into language anyone can understand. I was told nobody could ever love someone worthless like me. Thus, I need to find someone more worthless, someone who needs me, to be loved. I am suffering, and the world is evil. Thus, if a god who ordains this exists, he too must be evil. NHK is a show for everybody, and it doesn't discriminate. Despite Sator finding a job and his agreement with Misaki, their lives are still full of problems. And it's not just them. While Yamazaki and Hitomi seem to be in good places through their letters to Sato at the end of the series, we know Yamazaki was forced to give up on his dream of becoming a game developer and succumbed to his parents' expectations. We know Hitomi went ahead and had a child with the guy who she spent the whole series complaining about to Sato because the relationship made her lonely despite her partner having the money to lavish her and leave her wanting for nothing but actual attention and love. Or should I rephrase that? Yamazaki and Hitomi made realistic decisions nobody has any right to criticize them for, because life is hard and confusing, and if we spent all our time too scared to actually do anything, we wouldn't advance anywhere. We act, we make mistakes, we learn, we try again. Yamazaki and Hitomi made the best decisions they felt they could from the options available to them. Our values may dictate that in their situations we might have acted differently, but they're doing their best with the lives they've been given, and who could fault them for that? That's what NHK is about. Putting one foot in front of the other and somehow carrying on, because tomorrow might be that bit better. It's about finding imperfect solutions to terminal problems, because then we might get that bit closer to a chunk of that 10% happiness we're all chasing after. I think NHK harnesses a certain kind of bravery in telling a story that acknowledges not all problems can be fixed, and not all obstacles can be overcome. I have always loved the Serenity Prayer by theologist Reinhold Niebuhr. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. One of the moments in the series that hit me the hardest was right towards the end, where Sato and Misaki take shelter in her old abandoned house on the snowy night where they both attempt to kill themselves, and she simply asks him to tell her about his childhood. It doesn't matter what. And she's right. Sometimes it doesn't. Misaki and Sato's relationship is fucked up because they are. Aren't we all? Sometimes just sharing those parts of ourselves can somehow be enough. The scene where Misaki falls backwards off the promontory and Sato pulls her back with all his strength, where they sit in the snow and the reality of it all hits her, both that of her actions and of his, is perfection, pure and simple. A perfect portrayal of that instant where you realize you've shown somebody the most wretched, broken part of yourself and they've embraced it. That moment where you feel accepted, where you bare your soul and know someone can stand to see it, something even deeper than love. That is NHK's power. Sometimes we need stories that tell us everything will be okay, but sometimes we need stories that sit with us and acknowledge when it just isn't. Whether it's struggling with mental illness, not being able to find a job, lacking friends, or lamenting heartbreak or a romance that never even came to be, while our struggles differ, we've all been to those dark places. We've all wondered at one point or another whether any of this was even worth it. NHK is about those moments in life so utterly terrible you just have to laugh. So yeah, there's this scene in Welcome to the NHK that polarizes people. From Sato watching Hitomi accept her partner's proposal and immediately losing his will to live, to saying nobody cares if Hikikomori die anyway. From Misaki telling him she needs him to live because he's as worthless as her, to Yamazaki's heartfelt appeal that dramatic deaths just aren't befitting of them. From Sato finally acquiescing to Hitomi's tired, let's go home, to the heart-stopping moment where he slips. Some people say it's hilarious. Others say it's heartbreaking. This scene is tragicomedy at its finest. I did laugh at it. That doesn't mean there weren't tears rolling down my cheeks at the same time.